have some founders on that have come on that have come from a similar background where they're working at, you know, one of these big companies, and they sort of understand the secrets, or they understand how these companies begin to think, and they understand the threats that, you know, come on. And so we've had startups that are in two buckets. I'll give you a couple examples. So in one bucket, let's call it a completely natural almond milk, where it's four ingredients. The problem is shelf life, but it's completely natural. There's no gums, there's no fillers, there's no binders. It's just four ingredients in water, shelf life being 6-7 days, and it comes frozen. And so you have to add water. Now, if I'm a big corporation, I'm looking at these companies as a potential threat, but the reality is for anyone to really make it, you're going to have to mass produce and trade-offs will be made. When you were an executive or in, you know, in the room, let's call it, did any of this give you ideas as to like what they view as a potential threat, or maybe even let's call them blind spots, not even the threats, but like blind spots within the food market that because either the market's too small or it's just emerging? What was that like for you? And did it give you any ideas of like, oh, this could be something big because no one's paying attention to this particular problem or segment?
I think I saw, because I was my own consumer, I could see where there were gaps in white space, and it was around clean ingredients. It was around products that actually tasted as good as their normal counterparts. And then like putting my big CPG hat on, I think where I would view a company like ours as a threat is if we were able to bring other consumers to the category that they weren't able to appeal to, if we were able to gain mass distribution and start to eat away at even like fractions of their share points, I think would be eye-opening to a big CPG. And so for me, I was really working on solving my family's own problem, but I could see that there was a large market opportunity because I started to research, you know, how many people had food allergies, how many people may not have food allergies, but eat a restricted diet for personal or medical reasons, and how there was a gap in brands that really could appeal to multicultural consumers. And so I felt like there were a lot of places where our brand could play that could make it a large scalable company.
And then what was your first step? And so what was the first product you decided to either recipe develop or create? And probably having your daughter as like the perfect litmus test, right? Or maybe not. Maybe she's giving you feedback saying like, this is awful.
I got a lot of this is awful, which then made me very quickly bring on a professional. We worked with a food scientist who was able to bring my vision to life. I think I didn't appreciate how different it was, kind of the example you described. Like I could make a really good allergy-friendly cookie at home, but then it had no shelf life. It had stuff like, you know, you have to soak dates overnight and then blend them, stuff that just wasn't commercially scalable. And so we needed to bring someone in that could help us make the formula a lot more scalable.
And then what was your first line of products that you brought to market?
We launched with cookies. So we launched with three flavors of cookies in August of 2017 for a couple of reasons. One, because I wanted like a very simple celebratory product that people could share easily and felt like a nice indulgence. And then two, from a more practical perspective, we needed a top 8 allergen-free facility to produce our products in. And there's only two large ones in the country. And they could only make a small amount of product. So it was like, you know, I can make baking mixes or bars or cookies. And so I knew that we wouldn't have the capital to be able to start buying fancy custom equipment to make other products. So we went with something they already had. So there was kind of a twofold reason as to why we started with cookies.
That's shocking that there's only two of these facilities. Are they around you at least in Jersey, or are they somewhere else?
No, we actually produced in Idaho. I mean, that was probably one of our biggest challenges in getting the business off the ground, because they get to be really selective in who they work with, because there's a ton of food startups emerging and there's only a couple of places that can make these super allergy-friendly products.
Sure, that's tough.